Honorable President of the Andheri Court Bar, Shri Mishra Ji, Kushwaha Ji, Ojha Ji, and other committee members of Andheri Court Bar, and my fellow lawyers. It's indeed a pleasure to be invited to Andheri Court to discuss about the Indian Evidence Act. Andheri Court, I have been coming since inception because my office, my residence was very near at Juhu, opposite Amitabh Bachchan's bungalow. So this was my nearest court. And this is indeed a pleasure that we are meeting today to discuss about the Indian Evidence Act today. आपको इंडियन एविडेंस एक्ट की कुछ खूबियां पहले बताता हूं, फिर हम उसके कुछ पहलुओं पे चर्चा करेंगे. Now I was enthralled to listen to an experience of 90 years and still reading. Now think of the word which is used with lawyers, that we lawyers are practicing. We are never perfect. We continue to practice, and if a 90 years of experience is telling us that please continue to read, then think that how much is yet to be read by us. Thank you, Thakkar Sahab, for such words of enlightenment and wisdom. I once again wish you a very, very happy birthday. And on behalf of Andheri Bar, I wish you to make a century very soon. And I hope that we shall be celebrating Thakkar Sahab's century also over here. Now, coming back to the topic of today, we are here to discuss about Indian Evidence Act. Now, Indian Evidence Act is a very peculiar act. This is the only statute which applies both on civil law as well as on criminal law. 1st September 1872, this law was promulgated. Now, Section 1, if you see, of the Indian Evidence Act, it says that it applies on all the judicial proceedings except affidavits and except on arbitration. Now, this is surprising because most of the lawyers have this misconception that if they have notarized the document on affidavit, that becomes an evidence. Please be careful, because the Indian Evidence Act in Section 1 itself declares that this act applies on all the judicial proceedings, making exceptions of affidavit and arbitration. Though there is a judgment of Allahabad High Court where it has been held that as far as the affidavit is concerned, it is a discretion of the court to admit the affidavit as an evidence or not. Secondly, with the lapse of time and the practice, it has also come to the notice that as far as the arbitration proceedings are concerned, it is again the choice of the parties to arbitration as well as the arbitrator whether to use the provisions of Indian Evidence Act or not. And if all of them agree, then the Indian Arbitration Act can also use the provisions of Indian Evidence Act. Now, why I'm telling you is this, because these provisions, which are applicable since 1872, are still continuing. Although just last week I had an opportunity to meet the Law Minister of India, who was visiting Bombay. Ravi Shankar Prasad was here, and I had an opportunity to inform him that Indian Evidence Act needs a lot of amendments and a lot of improvements. Because ironically, if you see some of the provisions which have been added later on, after the IT Act of 2000 was introduced, we all are practicing lawyers, we must be facing this difficulty each day, that how to prove an electronic document, a digital document, an email. Now, provisions of Section 65B applies, but it's so cumbersome that if you read 65B of the Indian Evidence Act, you begin and by the time you reach to the end, you forget what is the beginning. It's so cumbersome, it's so badly drafted. And most of the times, even the courts find it extremely difficult to understand. Because if you see Section 65B of the Indian Evidence Act, it says that because it's a secondary evidence, you need a certificate along with the secondary evidence to produce before the court that this is a genuine document. But it's very difficult to find out who's to issue that certificate. Because 65B says that the person who's operating the computer or owning the computer can give the certificate. Now it's my personal computer, so my evidence, I'm only giving a certificate. It fails logic. So I had this opportunity and I told him that these things require streamlining. Secondly, most of the sections, if you go through Indian Evidence Act, still recognize the Act of Parliament of England. Now we are 70 years down the line, being independent, sovereign, but an Act of Parliament of England, why should it be treated as a conclusive proof? So there are various aspects which we will discuss in this course of discussion. But coming back, Section 1 also declares the territory on which Indian Evidence Act applies, which till now states except the state of Jammu and Kashmir, which I'm sure very soon will be changed. So now Indian Evidence Act will be applied throughout the territory of India. Thereafter, there is an interpretation clause under Section 3 and 4. Certain very, very important definitions every lawyer must understand, because to conduct a trial is like laying down a foundation of a building. In the words of my father, he was a senior counsel, Supreme Court, and he used to say that the practice of Supreme Court and High Court is superficial. The actual work is done in the trial court. So he used to say that, son, whenever you get an opportunity to attend a trial court, never leave it. Because in the trial court, the foundation of a case is built. And if the foundation is strong, the building remains strong. If the foundation itself is weak, however good the case at Supreme Court will collapse. तो ट्रायल की जो बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट चीजें हैं वो सेक्शन 3 में ही पता चलती हैं. पहली है फैक्ट. क्योंकि ट्रायल में फैक्ट बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट होता है. सुप्रीम कोर्ट और हाई कोर्ट के जितने लिटिगेशंस होते हैं वो लॉ पॉइंट्स पर होते हैं, पर फैक्ट ट्रायल कोर्ट में प्रेडोमिनेंट होता है. और सेक्शन 3 कहता है, डिफाइनिंग फैक्ट, इट सेज दैट एनीथिंग, स्टेट ऑफ थिंग और रिलेशन ऑफ थिंग इज अ फैक्ट. एनी मेंटल कंडीशन इज अ फैक्ट. तो अब आप देखिए, फैक्ट को अगर आप एनालाइज करें तो दो चीजों को वो कवर कर रहा है. एक है फिजिकल एक्टिविटी, कोई भी एक्ट हो रहा है वो फैक्ट है. और दूसरा है एब्स्ट्रैक्ट, कोई भी मेंटल कंडीशन वो भी फैक्ट है. तो ट्रायल में कौन सा फैक्ट ट्रायल का पार्ट बनेगा, इसके लिए फर्दर सेक्शन 3 कहता है कि जब कोई ट्रायल चल रहा है तो उस फैक्ट में से कौन सा फैक्ट फैक्ट इन इशू है. तो ट्रायल दो चीजों पर चलता है, फैक्ट इन इशू एंड रेलेवेंट फैक्ट. तो ये फैक्ट इन इशू और रेलेवेंट फैक्ट क्या है, मैं आपको समझाता हूं. सपोज अगर आप एक चोरी का ट्रायल चला रहे हैं और एक्यूज्ड पर एलिगेशन है कि उसने बी के घर में चोरी की है, फैक्ट इन इशू इज चोरी, और चोरी के ट्रायल को कंडक्ट करने के लिए अगर कोई ये बताए कि जिस आदमी पर, जिस अक्यूज्ड पर चोरी का आरोप है वो आदमी कुछ दीवार तोड़ने के हथियार लेकर जिस जगह चोरी हुई है उस तरफ वॉक करते हुए आधे घंटे पहले देखा गया था. नाउ प्लीज अंडरस्टैंड, वॉकिंग ऑन अ स्ट्रीट विथ सर्टेन इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स टुवर्ड्स एनी डायरेक्शन इज नॉट अ क्राइम. बट इन द ट्रायल ऑफ थेफ्ट, दिस वॉकिंग विद इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स टुवर्ड्स दैट हाउस वेयर द थेफ्ट हैज हैपेंड बिकम्स रेलेवेंट. तो फैक्ट इन इशू है चोरी, लेकिन उस फैक्ट इन इशू से पहले के घटनाक्रम और बाद के घटनाक्रम, चोरी के बाद जिस व्यक्ति पर चोरी का आरोप है वो बहुत सारे धन के साथ एक मेले में पैसे उड़ाते हुए पाया गया,